All right, hopefully you can all hear me. I'm gonna do my best and I hope my voice doesn't give out. Can everybody hear me in the back? Is that okay volume? So raise your hand, how many of you are here because you just wanted to hear what a recovering accountant is? Okay, I thought there'd be more of you than that, but. All right, so just real quick about myself, and then I'm gonna hopefully, if you guys don't mind, find out a little more about you and who I'm talking to. So. Graduated from Western, spent the first part of my career going in and out of public accounting and private accounting. I've always been more of an operational accountant and more business and strategic minded, and so they, in public accounting, they never really knew what to do with me. I was always kind of that problem child that they would push over to the side and say, go do some consulting or something. Ended up back in private accounting working in CFO roles. 10 years ago, I found my way to Moss Adams here in Bellingham, worked with our business owner succession group, and so that was pretty cool. What we got to do is sit down with business owners, talk to them about what their business was worth, what their goals were, and then help them set up and structure a transition for them into retirement. So whether they were selling to third-party sales, somebody that just wanted to buy their business, or family, or management buyout. So I learned a lot in that process, met a couple really nice people, Dwayne and Nancy McNett, and some of you may have heard of the company here in Bellingham called McNett Corporation. They've been recently renamed to GearAid, and they make some great outdoor products. And it was really great that I got to in that that position, got to kind of grow into my own in my career and become, went from the CFO, I didn't last long there as part of my recovering accountant phase, went over to the COO and spent time in operations running our leadership team and making sure we were delivering stuff to our customers, and then ultimately moved into the CEO role. And I'm gonna go through this just because if you guys have questions about any of this, I wanna make sure you hear this from me so you can, it might spur some questions. I've been through a lot in the last 10 years. So went CEO of McNett, literally took over in 2012, July of 2012 as CEO. August of 2012, our revenue through the military revenue got shut off. We went to 50% revenue on the month after I took over CEO. So spent the next 12 to 18 months in recovery mode, trying to figure out how to manage a company without laying everybody off. And get them back to profitability. We did a lot of really great things. I had a great team that helped get the company back to success. And by 2014, we had one of our most profitable years in the history of the company. At that point, the owners came to me and said, all right, no more going through that. We're ready. Let's sell this company. So then we spent the next 2-3 years setting the company up for sale and ultimately going through a transition to a third-party buyer. And it was just a fantastic experience. I learned a lot. There's a lot I would love to share with you. We only have a short period of time. So I'm going to share what I think is important, but what I would really love is if you guys have specific questions that you want to ask me, stop me at any time. I would rather answer your questions if it's valuable to you than just preaching to you and running through my slide deck. Okay? So where I am today, I like to think of myself as an entrepreneurial investor. I have an ownership stake in two companies, well, kind of three companies now. In fact, my partner, Paul Humphreys, is right back here. Go ahead, Paul, you can raise your hand. And we are looking at acquiring what will be my third business investment. And now what I like to do is I like to spend my time using what I've learned and my expertise and experience in accounting and finance and running a company to take companies that maybe aren't valued as well as they could, grow those values, and then transition them. So somebody brought up the phrase earlier, it's like flipping real estate. I hate to think of it that way, but to some degree there is. We're looking for good companies that have good foundation, but for whatever reason they're not valued as high as they should be. We can come in, take a look at those companies, hopefully do our magic, increase the value, and either collect the cash flow along the way or transition to another business at that point. Okay? So, before I get started here, where'd it go? Anybody just based on that, anything exciting, interesting that you would like to ask? Yes?
What was it you said you could do something?
I'm sorry, I can barely hear you.
What was it you said? You said I now consider myself as something
investor. Entrepreneurial investor. Okay, so we already did. I'm going to leave that up there for a minute if anybody wants to copy that down. I am more than happy to. I'm a Western alum, and I am here for you guys. If you have any questions, want to run anything by me, feel free. You can connect with me on LinkedIn if you want. I do love fishing. That was my first ever steelhead I caught on a fly. For any of you that have ever fished, steelhead is like the pinnacle of fishing, and catching one on a fly is even harder. So I love sharing that picture. Okay, here's what I'm going to try and do today. I guess I can see it here. I don't have to keep looking up. It wasn't supposed to go all through all three, but that's all right. So my animation's not work today. It may not work today, but that's okay. So here's what I wanted to do. I wanted to impress on you how powerful business is for creating equity. And we're going to talk a little bit about what I mean by equity. But if you can unlock the magic of leveraging a business to create equity for you, it's pretty incredible. Okay? And certainly I'm going to spend most of my time today talking in terms of financial equity, but there's a lot of other equity you can create with a business, whether that's jobs or small business economy, local economy, community, sustainability. There's lots of power locked up in a business to do great things for our communities. Okay? The second, I want to talk about a practical understanding of how. I'm going to give you guys some insight into how people go in and create value in businesses. And then finally, how maybe you can get started. Okay? All right. So this isn't going to work very well, because what I was going to do is say, somebody tell me what you think the definition of an entrepreneur is. This will be the shortcut version, I guess. I don't know that I think this is the perfect definition. Can you see the little hand? Yeah. But anyway, a person who organizes and operates a business, taking greater than normal financial risk to do so. Okay, we're going to talk a little bit about risk reward. The truth is, there's very few opportunities out there to get ahead without taking some risk. Okay, so if you become, like with any risk, when you become educated and understand what the risks are, you immediately minimize the risk from somebody who isn't educated and is ignorant about them. Okay, so that's part of what you're doing. You get an education, you go out in the work world for a while, you learn about how businesses work, become educated in it, you can then leverage that to grow value in business. Okay, equity, all right, how many accounting majors in here? All right, so equity is just the plug figure, right? It just makes the balance sheet balance. Okay, the truth is, equity is anytime you have a value that's greater than the claims against it. So that doesn't matter whether that's accounting or life, right? What we're all trying to do to some degree personally, especially once you graduate college, you're trying to get ahead in life. And what do we mean by get ahead? Well, you're trying to build some equity for yourself in whatever form that makes sense for you. Okay, we all want a lifestyle. We all have passions that we want to be able to work towards. And ultimately, we're hoping we can at some time in the future retire and live off of the equity we've created. Maybe transfer it to our children and help them get started. Okay? Let's see if I use this. Oh, look at that. Its animations are not going to work. Oh, well. And I'm going to go through this pretty quickly because an hour is not very long to get through all this. And I do want you guys to have time for questions. So if I'm going too fast, please just stop me and raise your hand. I'm happy to go slower. Okay, so a few universal truths that I wanted to talk to you about. Have any of you heard of the financial planner named Guy Kawasaki? Okay. Not a lot of heads nodding. He's kind of a retail version financial planner guy. You can buy books from him and processes to help you do your own personal financial planning. But I was reading one of his books and a story that's always stuck with me. He was telling a story of a gentleman who was at a McDonald's with his kids eating lunch. And one of his kids said something like, "Daddy, I want to one day learn or grow up and be able to work at a McDonald's and make money." And so this father used that as a great time to talk to his kids about how to make money, right? He said, well, that's great. You can certainly grow up and get a job at a place like McDonald's. And when you do that, what you do is you trade your time for money, okay? And that's what a job is. You trade your time, your expertise, your skills to somebody that's willing to pay you for them, okay? And it's typically by the hour. But you can also be an owner of a business. And if you look at this McDonald's here, there's somebody that owns this McDonald's franchise and they run this business. When you're a business owner, you leverage all the people that work for you and your investment in this business to create equity for you, and that's how you make money. You create a business process, a money-making machine that creates money for you. Or the third way is you can be an investor. When you're an investor, your money works for you and makes money for you. Okay? So those are just kind of the three ways to make money, and I thought that was a really great analogy because nobody had ever really, even though I'm a financial professional, nobody had ever sat down and explained it to me that way. I thought that made a lot of sense. The second thing that's going to be important when I talk through this is realizing there's two key types of investments. And this holds true for whether it's a publicly traded or a small business. Okay? Those two types of investments are either an income-producing investment or a value growth investment, okay? So you can go right now, if you look at the stock market, you can go buy stocks. You can take your $1,000, put it into a stock that's an income dividend paying type of stock. You're not really expecting the growth of the value of that stock to grow much, but you know every quarter it's gonna pay you a dividend, okay? That's a lower risk type of investment, and it's an income producing investment. Small businesses the same way. They have cash flow producing businesses, okay? A great example is a professional service business. So there's business people in this room. I know there's others as well. You can go out and hang your shingle out and start your own professional service firm. Start charging people for what you do. You're gonna generate cash flow, okay? I know as a CPA, you can go out and hang your shingle out, and there's a lot of CPAs in sole practice making, you know, $400,000 or $500,000 a year. And that's pretty darn good little business. But it's cash flow business. At the end of their life of this business, you're not going to really be able to sell that business for a lot of money. Okay? It was really more of an income producing stock. The second is you can have a growth stock. So how many of you would have liked to have invested in couple thousand dollars in Amazon 10 years ago, right? Amazon hasn't made hardly any money to date. I don't even know if they have made money to date. And I don't believe they've declared any dividends, all right? But the value growth of that stock has made a lot of billionaires and a lot of millionaires, okay? So that's a growth stock. And a growth stock requires that you buy low, sell high in order to make money, okay? And it's a transaction that creates the wealth, okay? You can't just hold on to that and have somebody give you the money. You gotta actually transition out of it. A small business, same way. You can have a growth company. Typically growth companies, think of a startup, right? When you're first in business as a startup, you're all about growing that company and you have no cash to send out to the owners, okay? If you were to go start a business tomorrow, say a restaurant, we were talking about restaurants a lot at lunch. If you were to go start a restaurant tomorrow, you're probably looking at 2 to 3 years before you can ever take a salary out of that business because the growth of that business is consuming all of the cash. Okay? Make sense? Okay? All right, and then the last one, and this is just universal, you can't get away from that, and that's risk versus reward. Okay? I'm gonna drop here. If this is a risk scale, okay, this is low risk, this is high risk, okay? Somebody just yell out, what's a low risk type of investment? T-bonds. What's that?
T-bonds.
T-bonds, T-bills, bonds, yes. Well, some bonds, we'll see. T-bills, okay, let's say municipal bonds. Okay, how about a high risk? What's that? Okay, stocks. Stocks probably run the gamut of about here to here. So what kind of stocks would be high risk?
Penny stocks.
What?
Penny stocks.
Penny stocks.
Technology,
startup technology companies, absolutely. What's that?
Biomedical.
Yeah, maybe. Okay, so I'm going to put penny. Okay, there's another one here, international. Startup. All right, so if you're talking about starting a business, okay, you are right out in this realm. All right. If you're looking at buying an established business, you're still a small business owner, but at least it has a track record. You know, you're getting more down into this realm. Okay. This right here is probably something like a Microsoft. Been around a long time. They're not going anywhere. IBM, the blue chip stocks. Okay. So the one thing I wanted to say about risk versus reward, though, jobs have risk too. Okay, so everything you're going to do out there to make money has risk. What I recommend for you is that you sit down and really think about your risk profile and where you want to fall as you go out into the real world here and start looking to earn money. I'll give you an example. Paul and I discussed where we sit on this scale. We said, well, if there's middle, we're sitting right about there. And what do we mean by that? We mean we want to leverage the power of small business, but we're not willing to take on a huge amount of debt to do so. We'd like our balance sheet to be pretty clean of debt, and we're willing to grow slower in order to take advantage of that. Okay? If it sounds too good to be true, it probably is. How many of you have participated in a Kickstarter, a crowdfunding? Anybody? Okay. So I may be wrong on this, but the sense I get today is like, okay, I can go come up with an idea, put it on Kickstarter, and I'm going to be on Oprah in a matter of months, all right? Okay? And I'm going to talk a little more about that. But the truth is, if it's too good to be true, it probably is, okay? Things just don't happen that way typically. There's few that do, but it's very rare. Okay. Just kind of talked about this already, so I'll go through this pretty quick. How do businesses create equity? Well, it's either an ATM where you're pulling a lot of cash out, or it's a growth stock. Okay, if you're going to be an ATM business, then it's up to you when you take that cash out to invest it. What I see a lot of times is professionals generate this, you know, doctors, attorneys, dentists, CPAs. CPAs are usually better, but doctors are notorious for this. Sorry if there's any doctors out here. They generate a huge amount of cash flow, but their lifestyle, their living is usually pretty high as well. So maybe they're making $400,000 or $500,000 a year, and they're living on $400,000 or $500,000 a year. Okay? Your business is not creating any equity for you if that's the case. You got to manage your money well if it's a cash flow business. Okay? As opposed to, I mean, you still have to manage your money well, but in the growth stock, what you're betting on is 10, 15, 20 years from now, you're going to sell that business. And the equity is built up within there. So your job then is to manage the business well to create value. Okay? All right, I'm going fast. Any questions? No, are you guys, you're not sleeping. I don't see anybody sleeping, so that's good. Mesmerizing. All right, now we're getting to the good stuff. There's probably no eraser though, huh? Okay, do I put the answers up there? Yeah, bummer. This is blowing my ability to ask you guys to see how many answers you know. Okay, how are businesses valued? So I'll talk in general, but then I'll tell you how small businesses are valued typically, because it really comes down to one method. If you've ever had real estate valued, you've heard of the term comps. Okay, comparables. Comparables is when you look at other like transactions and look at what value they were valued at, and then assume that because you're a like transaction, that's roughly setting the value for what your transaction's worth. Okay, in business, the most often used case of this is in publicly traded. Okay, if you're a publicly traded company, there's lots of good data about other stocks trading daily, and it creates this database of comparables that you can draw information from. Okay, small businesses, it's hard to find comparables. The only way you may be able to do that is like with trade industries. So if you're a CPA firm, the AICPA may have information on businesses that have sold, firms that have sold, that you can use to value your company. Okay? But typically, small business, that's not the way to do it. You can have liquidation or book value. Okay? Liquidation value is usually associated with a negative thing with the business. If you're liquidating the balance sheet and the only value on it is what those assets are worth if you take them to auction, that's not a good thing. So oftentimes we run across this, like if a business is insolvent, they're declaring bankruptcy. If it's in bankruptcy court, the other is divorce court. Unfortunately, all too often businesses are ruined because of divorce. Husband and wife start a business, they're 50-50 owners, get into a nasty divorce, and the business, frankly, just goes away because of inability to be compatible. But typically, liquidation or net book value is not how you value a going concern. Okay? The way you value a typical small business is going to be the earnings multiple or revenue multiple method. But if you take away anything from my presentation today, please understand there is a huge amount of power for you to grow equity using this formula. Okay? So what I want to draw here is, I know this is way over here, but you guys, can you see this if I draw big enough? Okay. So earnings times a multiple equals the value. All right. So I want you to think about this, and let me say here, earnings is usually EBITDA, and I'll tell you what that means here for those of you that maybe don't. EBITDA is earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization. Don't worry about that. Just know EBITDA usually means cash flow. Okay? How good a job is this business doing kicking off cash to its owners? So this is the money. Okay? The multiple is more the science or more the art side of valuing a business. Think of it as the machine. Okay? So the better job you do at growing a business that generates cash flow for its owners, the better machine you build, the better value you will get for it. Okay? Makes sense, right? If I own a business that hasn't seen much growth, our profitability is okay, we're making, you know, $100,000 a year in cash. A lot of the value, the way we make that cash is me personally. And I want to sell you my business, but I want to walk away. You're probably not going to pay me a lot for that because a lot of the value is going to walk away with me, and it's only making $100,000 a year anyway, right? Contrast that with a company that has an established team and a growth market. It's growing and thriving and kicking off $5 million a year of net cash flow to its owners. Is that going to be valued higher than the first? Yes. Would you pay more for that business? Yeah. Okay, because as an investor, what we're thinking of is return on investment, right? How quickly is this company going to pay me back for my investment? All right? But here's the thing I wanted to show you. This is so powerful. Okay, so literally the way the mechanics work here is a valuation person or a buyer and a seller will agree this part, they're going to look back 3 years, look at your average EBITDA. Okay, over the last 3 years. This part, you're going to have either a valuation expert or the buyer and seller agree on a multiple. And typically, those multiples are anywhere from 2 to 8. I've seen as high as 10, but it's pretty rare. Okay, so take an example. Let's say you have a business that's making $1 million a year in cash flow, and you get a valuation of 4. Okay, a multiple of 4. So your company is worth $4 million. That simple. Okay? But here's where the real power comes in. If you understand this formula, you understand that first off, every dollar I increase of EBITDA, I get a 4x leverage on that number. Right? So if I increase this from 1 million to 1,100,000, I get 4x that $100,000 in the value somebody's willing to pay me for that. Okay, that's huge. So if you see a company that's, you know, not as profitable as it could be, and you can go in and make some changes to that company that increase the cash flow, and you get a 4x multiple, that's a huge change in value. Okay, everybody get that? That's really powerful. Yeah?
Can you explain the multiple a little bit more?
Yes. So I'm glad you asked that question, because that's where I'm going now. Okay, so if this side is the cash flow, the money part of the money machine, this is the machine part. And think of a well-oiled machine. It's going to generate more cash. It's going to be better at kicking off cash than a machine that is clunky and firing on 4 of the 8 cylinders, right? So the way you get a higher, or the way a multiple is established, is they look at a variety of things. They look at things like, are you in a growth industry or a dying industry? Okay. Would you pay more money for a dying logging business or for a computer company that is showing great growth? Right? Okay, well, logging's kind of that's a tough industry. It's not dying, but it's certainly not growing anymore, right? Whereas technology companies, there's lots of room for growth. Okay? So that's one thing. Another thing that's factored into the multiple is the team. Like I said before, if mom and pop own this company, and the minute they retire, half of the business leaves because they were so loyal to mom and pop, then that's not a good money machine. Okay? As opposed to a company that has a really good, professionally run leadership team that's going to stay with the company through the transition, okay, and the owners retiring literally have little effect on the business at all, they're going to get a higher multiple than that mom and pop that take all the value with them. Okay? Let's see, what are some of the other things? That you've demonstrated growth, you've demonstrated profitability, that you have solid set of good, accurate accounting records, that you show up on site and it looks like a clean, well-run operation. Okay, so there's all these different elements that go into the multiple. And you remember, and this is, frankly, determining this multiple is why valuation experts get paid, because it's their job to assign that multiple. But for you, rule of thumb, back of napkin, if you wanted to figure out what a business is worth, okay, one way you can get at this is say, remember that risk-reward graph that I was talking about? Okay, well, if you want to invest in a company, what rate of return would you require on your money for you to give them your money? Okay, so said a different way, if I had $1,000 to invest in a company or $1,000 to put into the stock market, where am I going to make more money? Okay. Hopefully you're going to make more money in the business, but not necessarily. It's a higher risk, should have a higher return. Okay. So let's say I decided I needed to have, and I'm going to do this because it's easy math, I needed to have a 20% annual return to invest in your company. Okay. So treasury bills right now, you're going to get like a 0.0-something rate of return interest. Probably blue chip stocks, on average, you're going to be somewhere in the 3 to 5% range right now. And I'm just pulling these numbers out of air. But versus going up into penny stocks and really high risk things, you're probably well up north of, you know, sometimes even up close to 50% return on investment requirement. Okay? So if I wanted 20% return to invest in your company, you just take the inverse of that, 1 over 20% equals a multiple of 5. Okay? So if you said I needed 30%, 33%, okay, well, 1 over that, I need a multiple of 3. So lower risk, higher multiple, higher valuation. Right? Makes sense, because I'm willing to pay more for a company that's going to pay me more and is better established and has more growth opportunity, has a better team. Lower multiple, I'm not going to pay you as much because your value is walking out when mom and pop retire and you're in a dying industry, right? So really all I'm paying you for is the assets and a little bit of cash flow. Make sense? Okay, so the real magic comes in. Let me erase this. Obviously, you can increase this from 1 million to 1.5 million. Okay, just to make big numbers. Obviously, taking a company and growing it from 1 million to 1.5 million of profit, that's a pretty monumental effort, okay? But let's say you did, and you went from a 4 to a multiple of 6. Okay, you do the math. What is that, 9 million? Right? So you can get leverage from this formula on both sides. You can grow the cash flow by running a good business, keeping your costs down, pricing your product or your service well, okay, managing your supply chain, all the things you guys are learning, right? Doing good marketing, on and on and on. And you can do things to your business process, to that money machine, to increase the multiple you will get, okay? So keep in mind, these are things, the title of what I was discussing, the title of my discussion is Leveraging Entrepreneurship into Equity. So you all can take what you know about business, what you're learning in school, what you've seen, your experience, and understand this formula, and you can go in and help companies do this. Okay? Now, to get started, maybe you get a piece. Don't know. Right? I'm going to talk a little more about that. I'm getting a little ahead of myself. Any questions on the earnings multiple valuation formula? Yeah?
Does this take into consideration the amount of debt
Say that again, I'm sorry.
Does this formula take into account the amount of debt that you're having?
Great question. Okay, so let me come back to this phrase right here. So this is earnings before interest, which relates to your debt question. So I'll talk about that in just a second. Taxes, depreciation, and amortization. Okay? The reason they take off depreciation and amortization is because it's a non-cash expenditure, right? So if your company has a net profit of $1 million, but it has $500,000 of depreciation expense, your cash flow really is $1.5 million, right? So you add back depreciation and amortization. Okay, taxes. The reason they add back or take out taxes is because the entity I choose to run your company may be different than the entity you chose to run your company. And therefore, the tax effect of that may be different. If you chose to run your company as a C corporation and you're paying tax as a C corporation, and I choose to run your company as a pass-through entity, as an S corporation, I'm not going to have tax expense. Okay? Not at the corporate level anyway. All right? Make sense? Same thing with interest. Just because you chose to finance your business using debt doesn't mean I'm going to choose to finance your business with debt. I may be bringing my own capital and buying your assets completely without any debt. Therefore, I won't have any interest expense. So I can add that interest expense back to your profit to understand how much cash flow I will get when I own your company. Make sense? Does that answer your question? Okay, good question. Any other questions? You guys are just blown away by this? Ready to go out and buy your first company? All right. Okay, but there's a lot of other benefits, you know, that don't get talked about often, especially in school, that come with being a business owner. And this discussion kind of makes it sound like I'm really encouraging you guys to go out and be a business owner. That's not true. I don't think it's for everyone. But if you go out and work for a business owner, you are getting paid to help them think through this same stuff, okay? Because a business owner has goals that they're trying to achieve with that business, and when you come ask me for a job and I pay you, I have some expectation that you're going to help me figure this stuff out, right? Because you're coming on board to help me accomplish my goals. So whether you do this for yourself or you do it for somebody else, it's equally important. All right, so just real quick, what are some of the other benefits? Well, cash flow. So while you're running this business, nobody says to get $9 million valuation, you have to leave this $1.5 million in the company every year, right? You're generating $1.5 million of cash flow every year that you can take out as an owner. Now, you might have to keep some in to help grow and continue to keep the company revitalized, but Okay, so maybe I'm taking $1 million as an owner out. That's a nice little lifestyle, and I can grow my own equity outside of the company. Okay, so there's that. The second, rent. How many businesses do you know that are homeless? None. They all have to have some space. Now, there are virtual companies today, but in general, businesses have to have a physical space. They're paying somebody for that space. It's already figured into the expense. It's already figured into your cash flow, because it has to be. So why not pay yourself? Right? Rent to yourself. That's one of the biggest tax planning strategies that you'll find, is small business owners own their real estate, rent it from themselves. They transfer a high tax rate income out of a corporation to a lower tax rate rental. Yes, rental income. No? Okay, so then you're building equity in real estate as well. Okay? Deductions, obviously, you want to take as many deductions as you can. There's a lot of deductions open up to you as a business owner that you couldn't do otherwise. Okay, and at the end of the day, tax is just an expense. So to manage your business appropriately and build equity, you've got to manage that appropriately. And you should take every expense legally possible. You guys are probably hearing on the news about, you know, especially through the last campaign, which I hate to bring up the last campaign, but you heard a lot probably about corporations that are paying zero tax, but they're hugely profitable. All right, well, as long as they're not breaking the law, I'm okay with that. If you don't like it, we can change the law, but the truth is they are legally allowed to take those deductions. So are you, okay? You may not be able to pay for the high-priced legal and tax assistance that they are to help them find those deductions, but you can still take them. And then the last thing I'd say is just fringes, right? I mean, a lot of business owners have, their cars are paid for, their cell phones are paid for. Well, I should say, they're being deducted through the business. That's not a tax deduction you can deduct personally, but you can if you're a business owner. So again, those are just additional ways to save tax, which increase your ability to grow equity. Okay, lessons to live by. First one, ideas are like a-holes. Everybody has one. All right? I don't know how many times when I was at McNett Corporation, we would have people come into us with ideas that they were just ecstatic about, and they were completely impractical, or somebody had already done them, or they didn't have the patent or IP secured, or their pricing was all out of whack and we couldn't make money on it. Okay? Ideas are just the very tip of the iceberg start to getting a successful revenue and business model. Okay, so I just warn you, because I've had my own ideas, right? And you go from great idea to being on Oprah in your mind in like split seconds, right? This is going to sell millions. The truth is, all the work begins once you have the idea, all right? And most ideas are not new. I would highly encourage you guys to go spend some time, you know, pick an idea that you have come up with, or pick an idea somebody else has come up with. Go do the research, go do the Google search, go do the patent trademark office, go look on marketplaces and see if you can find other people that have had this idea and have tried to protect the idea, and just go search around. You'll find that a lot of ideas are not as new as you initially think they are. It's not to say you shouldn't be excited about your new idea. Just do your diligence. Crowdfunding. I brought it up earlier, but the thing I see is that crowdfunding solves one very critical, but one small piece of the challenge of a startup company, and that's funding, capital. Okay, and it's a really cool way to solve that, because you don't have owners giving you capital, you don't have banks that you're beholden to for that capital. Yeah, you have to deliver a t-shirt and maybe one of your first run products, but it's a great way to get startup capital, okay? But please do not confuse getting startup capital with having a successful business model. Because once you get that capital, now all the work begins. You have to figure out how to get your product, get the IP secured. You've got to get the packaging designed. You've got to get the distribution figured out, pricing. You got to have salespeople. You got to have sales reps. All this, website built, okay? you are just getting started. And the statistics are out on crowdfunding. And first off, the percentage of people that have a successful crowdfunding campaign are pretty low. Okay, so just even being successful getting the capital is pretty low. But then the businesses that were successful and actually leverage that into a successful long-term business model are very low also, okay? So I just bring that up. Again, if it's too good to be true, it probably is, if it sounds too good to be true. And I just want you to think it through, right? Experience. I just bring this up because you guys are college students going out to take over the world. Check your expectation, okay? Right now, you don't have a lot of experience. You have some education that you're going to go leverage into experience. And I have learned more in the last 5 years of my career than I did the previous 15 to 20. And partially because the world is changing so fast. I used the phrase earlier that being a CEO today is like drinking from a very large fire hose continuously. Okay? Data is coming at you constantly. People are coming at you constantly. Competition is just vigorously attacking you. I'll give you one example, distribution. Okay, if you sell products today, wind the tape back 10 years, most everybody was outsourcing products to Asia. Okay, and you would go create relationships with factories in Asia. You would have them manufacture your product. And yeah, they did some backdoor manufacturing, but typically they would protect the United States business for your product, okay? You could import that product and sell it here and do pretty well. Okay, now, fast forward to today, those same factories in China are producing their own products under their own brands and selling them into our marketplaces, okay? Without all of the steps of distribution to increase pricing. So, where if we go source a flashlight from Asia, and maybe we source it for $2-3, by the time it gets here to the United States, we have to sell that flashlight for $15 to $20 to make a profit on it. Whereas Asia only has $2 to $3 into it, by the time they get it here, they can sell it for $7.99, okay? All right, so if you are a manufacturer here in the United States, that's the kind of stuff you have to deal with today, and it just happens so rapidly. It's pretty crazy, okay? And then the last thing I'd say is cash. It makes the business world go round. So save your cash, grow your cash, grow your equity. People with cash make the decisions, okay? And they have access to the best deals, all right? Or find somebody with lots of it. Okay, so I tell you all of this. You're coming out of school. How do you do anything with it? Okay. First thing, sweat equity. Okay, I said on the previous slide, lower your expectations, be humble, go in with a humble approach. Talk to whoever you're going to work for. Tell them what you're hoping to do. Share your dreams with them. Invite them to a cup of coffee. Whatever you got to do, go to lunch with them. Buy their lunch. I can tell you as an employer, if you were to come to me and say, hey, would you have time for a cup of coffee? I know you're busy, but would you be willing to take a cup of coffee? Have a cup of coffee with me. Go to have a cup of coffee. If you were to sit down and say, look, here's what I'm really hoping to do. I know I'm green. I have not a lot of experience yet. Yeah, I have some good internships, and those are really valuable, but here's what I want to do. What do you suggest? Okay. When you do that, that immediately plants a seed in the back of that business owner's mind. And I'm thinking a couple things. One, wow, that person had some gumption to ask the CEO or the owner of the company to go to a cup of coffee. Good on them. And second, I know that they're motivated and I know what they want to do. And naturally, I'm going to want to try and help you do that. Okay? But you got to be humble in that approach. So you get in, you build some sweat equity, and then eventually you find yourself in a position where you say, hey, can I have a piece? Okay? Don't know what that ask looks like, whether that ask is a piece of, a profit pool, a piece of, phantom stock, a piece of equity, right? And you just kind of have to grow into that. But that's one way. You can use sweat equity. You got to make yourself indispensable and be humble. You can certainly go start a business. I just started one in July. Okay, it's a lot of freaking work. I can tell you that, and it has its days where it's extremely rewarding, and its days where it's extremely challenging. Okay, but a lot of people start businesses, some successfully, some not so successfully. You guys are learning what you need to do to manage a business well. So you just have to, you know, kind of mind your P's and Q's and manage your business well if you want to start it up. Startups mostly fail from what I've seen. The statistics show that most businesses startups fail because of lack of capital. Okay, what that means, they run out of cash. I would add to that, just based on my experience of working with small business owners, stupid business owners, okay? And I don't say that to be mean, but the truth is they're just not managing their business well, and they make some pretty crazy decisions that I leave me scratching my head, okay? If you learn the fundamentals of business and you leverage this and you're smart about it, you can be a successful business owner, okay? Buy a business. So here's the deal. The next 10 years is going to see unprecedented transfer of business ownership. We have a lot of gray-haired business owners who have no succession plan. Okay? They are going to be hungry for young people who have an entrepreneurial spirit that want to come in and help solve their problems. And solving their problems to a business owner who is, you know, 70 years old, working hard, and has no succession plan. First, you're going to come in and take a load off of them. Second, you're going to provide them with a pathway to maybe transition to a new owner through a management transition, okay? So just keep that in mind. You guys are still, because the next 10 years, you're going to be developing a lot of your experience and expertise, you're going to have to find the right opportunity, okay? You're going to have to kind of look for that. But if you are interested in that, there are ways to do that, and there's going to be a huge amount of opportunity. It's going to be the next 10 years, and specifically Skagit, Whatcom County, I can tell you that because I work in this area. Huge, huge opportunity. Going to be a buyer's market. You're going to be able to get good pricing because they're not going to have a lot of options. Okay? When there's a lot of sellers and not a lot of buyers, supply, demand, pricing goes down. Okay? The other thing that'll benefit you, one last thing. The other thing that'll benefit you is, in a buyer's market, you'll see the terms shift in your favor. So where 10 years ago, if you went and said, I want to buy your business, they'd say, great, you got to go cash me out. I just want cash. You pay me $3 million, I'll walk away. Today, they're saying things like, okay, $3 million, I'll finance the note. You just come in with $10,000 down and be willing to work hard, and I'll give you a low interest rate. Okay? So the terms will shift in the buyer's favor in the next 10 years. Yeah?
Do you see the growth in Whatcom County more in like service industry or physical goods? Or what do you work in?
Do you have one or the other? That's a good question. Bellingham's a little different than Whatcom County as a whole, just because of the college here. There's a lot of service in Bellingham proper. When you start getting out into the county around Bellingham and Skagit County, there is a huge amount of sleeper industry, manufacturing, product businesses that people don't ever hear about, but they're there. So I don't know specifically in Bellingham. I would guess probably more towards service-based. Yeah, but out in the county, you would definitely see some more industrial construction, manufacturing, that sort of thing. Any other questions? Okay, how am I doing on time? How much?
Six minutes.
All right, 6 minutes. All right, so I also put up there, look, there are great resources in most communities. I know Bellingham for a fact has these that can help you get started. Okay, there's the SCORE, which is a senior core of retired executives. Basically, people that have been there, done that, and now want to give back, and they love consulting, they do it for free. Okay, it's through grant money. You can go sit down with a SCORE counselor with your idea. They'll help you think through a business plan, think through a cash flow budget, how to get financing or capital. Okay. The Northwest Innovation Resource Center is another great resource we have in this community. If you are more an investor bent type of business, you know, you have a great idea and you want to get it past the idea stage, They work with a lot of investors or a lot of inventors to figure out how to get that from an idea to a product to a sellable product and a business model. Okay? And then there's other resources. I think, so here on campus, we have the Small Business Resource Center. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Small Business Development Center. I think there is a Small Business Resource Center here in Bellingham. So there's a lot, you just have to kind of seek it out. Okay? All right. Questions? I did good, huh? I went pretty fast. Most of you weren't sleeping. There's some that were. Oh, come on, guys. I just gave you a great presentation and no questions? All right. Yeah?
So, do you do consulting work at all?
I do.
Okay, so my arts management teacher said, if you're doing consulting work, then it's kind of sketchy to take a lot of equity instead of money. So, personally, what do you think it's about to do?
Okay, so tell me the part about equity versus money again. For the consulting itself? Ah, okay. So the question is, if you're doing consulting work for a small business, let's say, should you get paid in cash versus get paid in equity? Yeah, okay, great question. That's really dependent. Every situation is probably different. Probably if they're needing to pay you in equity, the chances are it's because they don't have a lot of capital and they're having to be creative with it. Okay, so that could be a sign of a business that is a little sketchy, and you know, do you want to be involved or not? That's a good question. But it also might be the sign of a great opportunity, ground floor opportunity. You have no cash into the deal, so there's little risk. Okay, you would want to look at the balance sheet and the financials, make sure that they haven't built up a huge liability that you're signing up for. Okay, one thing I'll share with you about minority ownership, okay? When you take minority ownership, you're really signing on for all the liability and no control, okay? Now, on the flip side, if you're giving minority ownership, you're signing up for a big pain in your butt later in life and very little upside because you're sharing a little bit of the risk, okay? There's a lot of minority shareholder laws out there that you need to be wary of and educated on. All right, so I say that because when you take a minority interest in a company as a consulting gig, there's a lot of risk there, and you may not have a lot of control. If you're taking on a controlling and they really are saying, hey, look, I don't know, what's your name?
Sean.
Sean, we really need your expertise to come into our partnership. There's three of us, we're gonna all share, start this business 30% each. Maybe, you know, that might be a good way to get started. Okay. Good question. Any other questions? Yeah.
As a CEO of a company, what is the biggest lesson you've learned?
Say what was what?
As a CEO of a company, like, what is one of the biggest lessons you've learned?
Oof. All right. Just off the top of my head, let's see. One we were talking about earlier is there are leaders and there are people who want to be led. Okay? And what I mean by that is that it's one thing to sign up to be a leader. Like you think about a project and you're the lead on the project, right? And you're kind of responsible for keeping everybody in line, getting the project to deadline, meeting all the goals, etc. It's a whole nother thing to inspire people to take action. Right, and inspire people down a mission or a value that you find passion in. Okay, but you'll find that when you don't lead, your team starts to get really squirrely and really nervous, and weird things start to happen culturally. Okay, and what that is a sign of is a weak leader, and it's because people really want to be led. They want to know where we're going, why we're going there, what's important. Okay, so I would say that's a really big thing. You gotta realize there's people that just want to be led, and that's okay. We need both. Just like You need people in your business that are perfectly happy coming in every day, taking this widget, putting it here, and doing it repetitively all day long, every day. You need people to do that. There's work that has to be done. And there is nothing wrong with that. That's not a demeaning position. You will find that there are people in this world that makes them so happy. Okay? Your job as a leader is to find those people and get them in the right spot. Okay? Good question. Hard answer. There's a lot of lessons. Another one I would say, I was bringing up earlier, do the right thing. Just do the right thing. Always make the decision to do the right thing. If you do the right thing by people, by your customers, by your vendors, by your employees, if you do the right thing with business deals, you can go to bed at night and rest easy, knowing that it may blow up, but you did the right thing and there wasn't any underlying bad stuff you did, right? You weren't out to harm people. So just make the decision, do the right thing. Make that a good core value. Okay, good, done. Yeah. All right, thank you.